Our invited guest today is Min Hyung Song, who's professor of English and director of the Asian American Studies program at Boston College, as well as a steering committee member of environmental studies and an affiliated faculty member of African and African diaspora studies. And his most recent book is Climate Lyricism, published by Duke University Press earlier this year. So we invited him to chat about this highly topical book. But before we talk about climate lyricism, let me also introduce the others who are here. So we have as discussants Katarina Maria Kalinowski, who is a poet and eco scholar. And she completed a joint PhD in English and poetry text practice as research at the universities of Cologne, Kent, and Dublin. And currently she teaches creative writing at Düsseldorf University. And her creative critical research explores eco-poetics, poetics, eco-translation, and the Anthropocene and Capitalocene. And her work can be found in the Journal of British and Irish Innovative Poetry, Ecozone, Magma, and the Irish Poetry Reading Archive. And then we have Isabel Carvalho, whose artistic career is characterized by a strong experimental component influenced by her research in the fields of philosophy and literature. And her work also intersects with the arts, sciences, and speculative knowledge. And in her projects, she recurrently addresses issues related to the materiality of language, including nonverbal forms, with the aim of raising awareness and contributing to the preservation of diverse ecosystems of sociability. And her work has been developed in the close articulation between visual arts, writing, and editing and publishing books. An array of expressions or means that over the last few years has expanded the sculpture and the occupation of three-dimensional spaces. And she exhibits individually and collectively on a regular basis, and she was responsible for the Navio Vaggio project, a temporary occupation space of editorial experimentation in three dimensions. And in 2017, she started the magazine Leonorana as an author and editor. All right, so those are the introductions. So Isabel or Katarina, would one of you like to start with the first question, perhaps?
Well, I just prepared some very simple questions, I hope. Mm-hmm. One is, I will begin for this one, thinking and doing at the same time. When I follow your idea, I think whether it is writing and reading forms of activism, and if it is important to believe that these forms of action really have an impact on the events taking place in the planet. So I will make this just a group of small questions. And I would like to also to ask how important is the formulation and construction of shared imaginaries as tools to survival, and how is it important to expand these imaginaries that present climate change and the associated problems. And then I also would like to put the question of, in the literary model that you propose, is there a specific knowledge being created in form? Because this reminds me also other, not other, maybe similar notions of new knowledge that has been created on the same matter, which could be called also civil epistemologies concerning environmental issues or environmental knowledge or popular environmentalism. So these are my three questions.
Thank you so much for that. It's a lot to answer. Let me see if I can try to approach them. Maybe first with the, I think the first question seemed to be really about the relationship between thinking and doing. Second, maybe a question about scale. And the third, a question about epistemology. So the first question about thinking and doing, I think what's maybe a little bit different about my approach to this question, because I'm hardly the only one who said that that thinking and doing need to be fused together and work with each other. But I often think that when people talk about that relationship, it's often always the thinking precedes the doing, you know, like you have the theory and then you have the praxis. What I wanted to suggest in the book was a much more reciprocal relationship, that the thinking and the doing can't be separated, and that in fact, the doing is also a kind of thinking, that when you take action in the world, big or small, it leads you to new ideas and new thoughts that you wouldn't have had otherwise, you know. So you might think, for instance, that it's important to do something about climate change on a kind of everyday level, compost, you know, ride your bicycle, all those things. But when you start to do those things, what I've found is that you start to get new ideas and a new appreciation that you wouldn't have gotten if you weren't doing those things. You know, you have to develop practical knowledge. There are problems you didn't realize until you started doing it, challenges that become bigger, and your sense of the world changes. One example that I give is that I've made an effort to not drive to work anymore. My campus is about 2 hours from where I live, and so I've been either riding my bicycle or walking, taking trains, some combination of those. When I ride my bicycle to work, I start to realize things that I hadn't known or thought much about before, like elevation, the fact that my office is actually located on top of a hill and it's mostly uphill, suddenly presents a problem I hadn't thought about when I was just driving, right? I'm much more aware of the weather than I'm used to be. You know, I didn't think about the weather that much. And when I just go into my car and then drive, it really didn't even matter what I wore. I wasn't outside very much. But then when you have to spend substantial amounts of time outside, you really have to pay close attention to the weather. Is it going to rain later? How windy is it? What does it feel like? How do I dress? And almost always I get the, you know, I get the dress part wrong. I'm always either overdressed or underdressed for the weather. It's so frustrating. But it's like an intellectual problem suddenly that's very practical. And so it changes my relationship to space because I'm aware of elevation in a way that I wasn't before. It makes me much more aware of the weather. It certainly makes me much more aware of the built environment because, you know, there's the experience of space changes so dramatically from when you're driving to when you're walking or cycling. When you're cycling in particular, you really begin to understand how the built environment has been designed for the automobile almost exclusively at the expense of all other uses of that space. And how sometimes like very nice, very reasonable people change when they're behind the wheel. And part of it is because of the built environment and that experience. And so it turns into a different kind of intellectual experience when you start to apprehend the environment, not as a motorist, but as a pedestrian or a cyclist. And so that's been really enlightening for me to think about, you know, how much my own thinking changes depending on what I'm doing. And that there's a kind of materiality to my thinking as a result connected to physical activity. So maybe that's one way I would try to explain that relationship between thinking and doing. And I think in some ways, the doing makes the thinking a little more practical. You know, you have like real practical considerations you've got to figure out. And also to think about how to render that experience in new ways. Scale is such a big problem, right? I mean, The kind of activities that I'm advocating for does sound like individual action. And I think rightly you might ask, well, what's the use of individual action when we're talking about big social changes that are necessary, right? Aren't we just cultivating some kind of personal virtue, or aren't we placing the burden of change on individuals? And I think that's a really serious question. I'm actually sympathetic to that idea. And I can also see why corporations would be very keen to sort of get us, and governments and corporations would be very keen to put that kind of burden on the individual to make change. Yeah. On the other hand, I do think it is through the kind of everyday modifications in our behaviors that we begin to apprehend the practical nature of the challenges before us, and can act as an occasion to interact with other people, and to begin to build forms of sociality that might not have existed before. To create maybe blocks of interest, you know, like cyclists, once you start cycling, you start to then get involved with other cyclists, and you start to think about how do I rebuild the infrastructure so that it is more friendly to cycling, right? Or more friendly to pedestrians. Why is so much of the public space dedicated to automobiles? And why are they given so much priorities to the point where we're giving a massive subsidy to the automobile industry? So, you know, I think it provides occasion for all sorts of collective action. And once you start to form into collective action, then you can have an impact. Then you can address the kind of scales, at least locally, the kind of scales you need, right? And what you want to do is to find ways to get as many people involved and engaged in these things, offer practical advice about how to get involved, create new networks that can grow and flourish. We don't really know what's going to work, so we have to keep trying a lot of different things and hope something sticks. And I think it's a mistake to say we should just wait until the state decides finally that this is a problem and they're going to tell us what to do and we'll just follow along, right? That may never come, for one. But even if it did come, if you haven't already built a large group of people who are already acting and doing and thinking about these things. And those policies are going to fall flat. You know, you're going to have lots of people who are resistant to change at that level, who don't see practical solutions. If the state suddenly steps in and says, you know, you have to do X or Y, but we don't really have a clear guideline, or, you know, you have to upend your whole lives, that's going to lead to a lot of resistance as well. And we've got to figure out a way to, you know, sort of smooth out that process, because it's just really, really clear to me that change is necessary and we need change. I don't know if anything I'm saying is new as far as the epistemologies go. I'm sure a lot of smart people have been thinking about these issues, and I'm just trying to add my voice to what's already there. I've made every effort I could in writing the book to read capaciously. And indeed, one of the points I tried to make in the book, and that was very important to me, was not to get stuck on the close readings of just a handful of texts, as if they're the only ones who could provide wisdom on the subject. There is absolutely a place for close reading, but it has to be complemented by an attention to as wide a variety of texts as possible to be really capacious readers, and to think about what happens to our habits of reading when we insist on the importance of thinking about ecological and environmental issues alongside issues of race, gender, sexuality, class, and so on.
Thank you. I guess you just maybe I'm not sure if you want to just pass by a little bit to the topic of epistemology, this kind of knowledge that is built.
Yeah, that's a tough question, and one I've been thinking a lot about, because my earlier work was on race and literature, and I was really interested in Asian Americans in particular, who aren't that well known. And at the center of my interest in those subjects was epistemology. It was a question of how do we know the things that we know? How does knowledge get produced? In the case of Asian Americans, I've always found that I've always thought that subject was really interesting in the sense that they were so invisible for so long. And in many ways, the categories kind of invented at the end of the 1960s. And so you can kind of see in some ways the production of a group identity based on race that, you know, that's really manufactured in plain sight. And people want to reject it as being sort of less real than other things, though I think one of the contributions of Asian American studies is to challenge our ideas of the real and to make us see in some ways how our understanding of reality is always under a lot of pressure and stresses, and that there are multiple ways of seeing something. So epistemology is absolutely important. In the book, I really stress a lot about the importance of sort of paying attention to climate change, creating a cultivation. In many ways, you know, I think building on what scholars of race and literature like myself have insisted on for a long time, which is that we deliberately have to ask ourselves the question, well, what does race have to do with this? You know, and that changes our sense of everything we read, at least in the American context, but I'm sure elsewhere as well. And I think, you know, so similarly to insist, well, what happens without forgetting, you know, things like race and so on, what happens when we pay attention to climate change? Insisting on that attention. But more and more, I've also have become persuaded that not only do we need to pay attention to climate change, but we also need to pay attention to the way we pay attention to climate change. And that's the epistemological question, right? There are lots of ways of paying attention to climate change, which we're seeing more and more of, especially I think as people who were skeptical and denialists have now been forced to concede that indeed something momentous is happening to the world's environments. But it matters how they concede that point, right? And it really matters how they're paying attention. And so we as scholars, especially literary scholars, I think, are uniquely positioned to offer that insight, you know, to make sure that we are paying attention to the way we pay attention is something that literary scholars in particular are very good at.
Thank you.
All right, yes, excellent, thank you. Well, Katharina, would you like to ask something next?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this conversation. And I really enjoyed reading the book. I think one of the best things books can do is just make us engage with more books and make us produce writing as well. And I was so inspired when I was reading the book, and I found myself writing a lot of poetry. I was just really intrigued by what you just said about the reciprocity between thinking and doing. And just when I was thinking about it now, I was wondering how much tension that also creates. I was just thinking of an event that recently happened at one of our universities. So there was a group of climate activists that came in and occupied a lecture hall to give a talk on climate change. And this was at my partner's university, and one of his colleagues got really angry because he said they might well interrupt an event where the person who might be able to make a change is not able to because they cannot attend the lecture. Now, this person was an engineer, and clearly they were thinking about technological solutions, it's like preventing climate change and so on. But it just got me thinking about all the ways that thinking and acting are so complicated, and they are entangled in much larger networks, and we never know what happens when we act, and acting is not necessarily always a good thing. I suppose in literature and in the literary discourse, we often think of action as something that is inherently good. So texts make us act, we need to act and we separate acting and thinking and so on. So I was just intrigued by that tension there. And then my other question, which is kind of the big question, I suppose, is I'm just really curious to hear more about the term climate lyricism, because of, and its relationship to poetry as well and poetics. I was just really curious why you picked the term, I suppose. And obviously you write a lot about how it can, how it is able to hold attention and come out of the ruins in a way. I thought that was really interesting. But yeah, just lyric and lyricism, it's also such a difficult and empty in a way term. So I was just really curious to hear about more of the term and why you picked it.
I think they're both kind of related to each other, actually, these questions. But let me address the first question because it's such a rich and interesting one. And it probably also reflects my own developing thinking on the subject since the publication of my book. In the book, I really felt the need to emphasize the importance of acting because I felt so much like, you know, our attentions hadn't caught up to the momentousness of what's happening around us. And I said, you know, at one point I said in the book, you know, that panic is definitely a problem. But at least panic acknowledges that we're in a really, like, you know, emergency situation, that things are really dire and there's urgency and the panic seems commensurate to the moment in a way that, like, cool distance doesn't. I talk also about Lauren Berlant's idea of genre flail, the sense that we're like just trying a lot of different things because we don't know what's going to stick. And I think the example you provide of the students who are interrupting the lecture is an example of genre flail, actually, you know, like trying new storytelling, trying something different, seeing what sticks. But my emphasis then on like a call to action has also, you know, been challenged by recent events. I was especially struck, for instance, about the recent, you know, climate action where the young people threw soup at a famous painting by Van Gogh. You know, was that the action I had in mind when I was writing my book? I don't know. You know, I admired what they did. And they certainly arrested public attention in a way that very few things have. There's also the sense that, you know, as a genre, that kind of public action constantly needs to scale up the spectacular nature of what it's doing to maintain even that same level of attention. It's a little bit like a summer blockbuster film. You know, every year they have to do something even more preposterous, you know, some try to show something more spectacular that audiences haven't seen just to keep audiences attentive. And so there's a kind of spectacular nature to that event. And there is also something very theatrical about it, because as they themselves admitted, they knew there was glass and that the soup was not going to damage the painting. And I had a hard time not thinking about AYY's very provocative mid-90s series of photographs where he drops a Ming vase, you know, priceless vase on the ground and shatters it. Now there was a spectacle that really had stakes because he was destroying something that was irreplaceable. It made me wonder what would have happened if they actually did destroy that painting by Van Gogh, you know, terrible, shocking. But, you know, would that have been something that really did change the discussion in a way that I think what they did arrested global attention for a while, but quickly receded, you know, I think we would still be talking about them today if they actually destroyed it. Now, I'm not advocating that they should destroy like famous paintings. I'm just thinking aloud about these things. And so I guess what I would say now is, you know, tempered with a call to action, tempered with the need to experiment with a lot of different forms, is also the need, maybe counterintuitively, to step back a bit and to offer some thought and meditation on what's happening, you know, that we do need spaces to reflect. And that sometimes action can be worse than no action, you know, there's certainly lots of forms of climate action that are taking place that do feel kind of panicky and are unlikely actually to alleviate the situation, but actually make things worse. I think a lot of like border security policies, the increasing militarization of the border, I really think of that as a kind of climate action, actually, and not a very well thought out one. Rather than jump to that, I think there should be lots of space and discussion about what kind of action that is, and if that's the desirable, you know, course that we want to follow. You know, so that's an issue. Just maybe trying to think more, and I'm still processing this, but trying to think more about when should we be diving into action, and when should we take a step back and try to assess what it is that we're trying to accomplish, and if this is the way to accomplish it. So as far as climate lyricism goes, it is a kind of a big term that I've used, and as you say, it's a bit of an empty term. It's been used so widely, and I think understandably been associated problematically with the entirety of poetry. I do think my trajectory on this subject is a little unusual in the sense that I think a lot of people who write about poetry, if it's not too much of a generalization to say, a lot of people who write about poetry started with poetry. You know, they love poetry, they loved reading poems, and they build out from that base, you know, and the kind of claims they make about poetry stems from already a very wide and deep familiarity with the subject. I didn't have that kind of familiarity. I mean, I certainly studied poetry when I was in grad school, but most of my focus and attention in my writings and in most of my published work has been about prose. And the novel in particular has, you know, sort of left me mesmerized for many decades. But when I was doing research on the subject in its early stages, and for a very long time, really stuck on it, you know, and I kept asking myself, well, what do novels have to offer? And I just couldn't come up with really good answers to that question, even though now we have a burgeoning field of climate novel, you know, climate fiction. But I felt increasingly sort of disaffected by the novel, frustrated by, you know, by some of its limitations. And I found myself actually reading a lot of poetry. So and the poetry seemed to answer some of the questions I was having. So I come to this subject as someone who's you know, a specialist in prose fiction, who is interested in the topic of climate change and the ways in which it intersects with all other aspects of social life. And that interest is what led me to poetry. And there's something to me, I guess one way to put it is to say that one problem with the novel is that a lot of it is so fixated on the end, on a resolution, on a conclusion, and the plot is all about like kind of create some kind of resolution. And that's problematic for us now, because we're really in the middle of things. You know, I think we are in a moment of dramatic change. And we really don't know what's going to happen next. You know, we certainly don't know how the story ends. But I also think we don't even know what's going to happen next. I mean, if you just look at the United States, for instance, right? It's been over a week since our national midterm elections, and the results have surprised many political observers. And we still don't know yet what the resolution of several important elections will be, including who's going to control the House of Representatives. We still don't know, you know. So we do seem to be living in a kind of knife edge moment where anything seems possible. And so, you know, any fictional attempt to try to create a plot that drives us to a conclusion about a moment that's so fraught with uncertainty is going to feel unsatisfying. What I found with poetry, and in particular with the lyric, is its fine attention to the present that I found just really, really important as a kind of aesthetic intervention into thought. You know, how do we stay with the moment of uncertainty? How do we pay attention to what's there before us, to the present, to the moment, and find ways to give shape and form and language for understanding the present that we occupy? That's what I found the lyric offered me.
Thank you so much.
All right. Yes, that is very, very intriguing. And one of my own questions that I had was really, really about a similar topic. I had a question about the notion of climate lyricism and how that came about. And then I was also going to ask about what you think poetry can do, but I guess you already answered that. So let me try to rephrase this a little bit. I guess, in the beginning of your book, you write that you want to find ways to democratize agency that break the spell of powerlessness, so that thinking about climate change emboldens rather than leads to a shrinking back, and models that are aware that any one form of agency is not the only source of action in the world, models that work actively against notions of a preordained progress and mastery. And I think that's a very interesting way of putting things, and something that also strikes me as interesting as someone who is a poetry scholar, because I have for a long time had this belief that poetry is capable of working for shared activity in ways that other genres of writing necessarily perhaps cannot so easily do, particularly because poetry is often so focused on focusing on readers' attention, or focusing readers' attention on constructing meaning together and things like that. I think that's something that's very, very prominent in poetry. So I guess the question then is, do you see this kind of working against progress and mastery? Do you see this particularly in poetry in ways that doesn't really happen in novels?
Yeah, I think the work of certain poets, for sure, they are working very hard. I mean, like everything, poets are very heterogeneous in their thinking and their approach to these things. But there's lots of poets who I think are working quite actively to think about what it means to be in a moment, to have some humility, to not strive for mastery, or to try to create a kind of narrative that leads us inexorably just to one conclusion, but really maybe invites us to see the different possibilities before us and the ways in which they may branch out in different directions. I think there's just a lot of really fabulous poetry right now that's being written, and I regret not being able to read more of it. There's just so much. I'm also a very, very slow reader of poetry, I have to say. So, it takes me many, many times to read a book again and again and again, you know, and some poems again and again to make meaning of it. It's for me absolutely an exercise in kind of the opposite of mastery. I don't know what that is, but like a kind of humility or uncertainty, because, you know, a lot of times I just don't even know what I'm reading or understand it. And I nevertheless feel some sense of power in it, you know. And so it does take me a long time to read and think very carefully. It does slow me down. And it teaches me to, you know, to keep looking at the same thing in different perspectives, and to keep returning to it in a way that I think is a really healthy way. Actually, it's a really healthy training in an important democratic sensibility. or you don't go into a discussion with other people, assuming you already know the answer and it's your way or the only way, but that it is about constantly revisiting what's there before you together in dialogue to try to make sense of what's there and work together, right? And then actually the kind of working together, the debate is also how you might develop kind of healthy social relationships, because it keeps you engaged with one another. And I think there should be a place in sociality, not only for congenial agreement, but disagreement. You know, this is right now, I think there's a very lively and important global debate happening around the use of social networking, social media technologies, about what is the best way to try to communicate with one another, right? There's the kind of competitive mosh pit of Twitter, for instance. And then the more sort of civil federated model of Mastodon that, you know, a lot of academics have moved toward. And it's really interesting to think about how they both are in many ways thinking about the same kind of question, you know, especially academics who are involved in that, you know, what's the best kind of ways in which we can have productive conversations with people. This technology is amazing because it allows a lot of people from a lot of different backgrounds and places to talk to one another and exchange ideas almost on a daily basis. I think it's an extraordinary technology. But how to do that? You know, in some ways, I think the algorithm that drives Twitter drives or rewards people who want competition, who wants like sensational, right? The spectacular is always rewarded with attention. A place without an algorithm like Mastodon, which is really, as far as I can tell, kind of like a series of interlinked group chats where there's nothing driving attention, right? Except for the people who are involved and who's also committed to a certain kind of civility can feel cooling and calming and also boring and also unwilling to create space for debate, for like riotous debate, which is maybe what we need. In many ways, what it seems to me is that neither of them quite satisfy a widely felt desire for some kind of short space of exchange and connectedness, especially now when I think we are all feeling so fragmented in the wake of the pandemic, but even before that, feeling so already so dispersed and divided and in many ways, you know, I think just so many people are so alone, you know, like that kind of technology is really attractive. I would also make a pitch that poetry does have a space in a way that is potentially exciting. I don't know if we've arrived at that point yet, but if there's ever been a moment in the last 30 or 40 years for poetry to regain the kind of readership and stature that it once used to enjoy so profoundly, it's this one. For a number of reasons, if I may. One is a lot of people, not just young people, but a lot of people have a really hard time reading long form prose. Our attention just doesn't work that way because of lots of reasons, probably having to do with the media and technology. And in many ways, our attention is finely tuned for the lyric, for short bursts of careful attention to language, you know, because that form is so much like the forms that we are seeing on like social media platforms. And there's also something, you know, that because of its brevity lends itself to sociality, right? Going to hear a poetry reading is in some ways such an important part of it, of poetry. It's a very oral, it's a very collective action. It's about language, but also about the rhythmic movement of language across very carefully consigned lines. there is in the attention to language, a careful attention to silence and breath. That's just already so social. I'll just add that at my school we were fortunate to have Ocean Vuong come speak, who's this really, you know, I think you all probably know him already. I think he's just a phenomenal writer. And we were in this very big room, and it holds about 300 people, and it was standing room only. People were like lining up outside the door, just trying to listen. People were standing in the back and along the sides. And for, you know, for like a good 40 minutes, Ocean read his poetry. And it was an amazing experience. He's a very soft-spoken, a very deliberate speaker. And so the audience literally held its breath for the whole time that he was speaking. So every time he read a poem, you could hear the whole audience just kind of take in a breath and be just completely still. I've never been in a room with so many people where everyone was so completely still. Like everyone was just very mobilized and they were listening to every word he had to say. There's some students who had brought his book with them because they'd been studying it in their classes. And they're actually following along, reading as he was reading out loud. And then he'd finish a poem. And everyone go, and then everyone was like shifting and trying to adjust themselves. And then they would stop again as you read again, you know. It was such a great experience, you know. And I think for my students, just such an amazing experience, especially after 2 years of being apart and not having that kind of occasion to be so packed into one space, to be packed in together, to share that moment of stillness, listening to that poetry. I just don't think if we had invited a novelist, that person would have had the same effect on the audience. I just don't.
Yes, that indeed does sound wonderful. And yeah, I hope that we will indeed see a revival of poetry in addition to the revived lyric, which is a concept that you talk about in your book. Maybe I'll then ask a question that Joao sent. He sent me some questions, even though he wasn't able to come. So. One of his questions concerns the idea of everyday denial that's developed in chapter one. And so perhaps first you might want to recapitulate what you mean by that, just so people can understand what we're talking about. And then his question is, might it not be the case that rather than living in denial, people just see the obstacles in the way of real climate change mitigation as too difficult to overcome? Gradualism might make things better, but isn't it the case that in order for substantive change to be possible, capitalism itself would have to go? And if that is the case, are we not dealing with impotence of a different kind?
Thanks for that question. It's one I've struggled with a lot. So in that chapter, I was thinking a lot about different kinds of denial, that there's not just one. And I was working with, in particular, with the work of Stanley Cohen, I believe his name is. But he argues, you know, that there's kind of the literal denial. You know, you just say climate change isn't real, that science is made up, you know, the Chinese are doing it, something like that. I think increasingly that doesn't exist anymore. You know, it's very, very hard to find people who will now say climate change is just all made up. There's still people like that, you know, but they're kind of, I hope, increasingly marginal to any discussion, any serious discussion about policy. But then you have another layer, interpretive layer, right? Where you can see the facts before you, but the frame you use to interpret the facts are leery. So this is maybe not the paying attention to climate change, but the paying attention to the paying attention of climate change, right? The interpretive nature. And you can see all sorts of things and fail to put those pieces together, right? You could see flooding, you could see wildfires, and you could kind of not connect it interpretively to the, you know, to the burning of fossil fuels. You know, it's just kind of like terrible thing that's happening. How horrible. But you have to be able to have a kind of a model for explaining all of these things, right? To be able to interpret them properly. And that requires a certain level of scientific literacy to understand the sort of at least the basic science of what's happening, to be able to then say, well, this is why this is happening, right? You know, what's causing the flooding in Pakistan this summer, or what caused that flooding, which was so terrible. You have to understand something about the science and understanding about how water works. So there's that interpretive level, right? Which I think education can offer a lot, you know, is really important to educating people about how these things are connected and what processes are work. And then on top of that, though, you can't just have like, you know, an acceptance that this is happening and a model for understanding it. Then you've got to say, okay, what are the consequences of having this thought out model of understanding about what's happening, right? You can't say, oh yeah, I understand it all. It's clear to me. And I'm just going to go about and live my life the same way as I did before. That's kind of denial too. So you do need to connect it to the consequences there to be fully engaged, right? I think the one example that was used in Cohen is like to think about South Africa during apartheid. You know, there was always the literal denial that anything bad was happening in that society toward Black people. But then you could get past that and then connect it also to the policies of the government, to the various social structures involved, you know, and have an understanding of that. But people could have a full understanding of how awful apartheid it was and still sort of, you know, not do anything about it and go about their day. That's a kind of denial, right? And you wouldn't have fully overcome denial in that circumstance if you weren't working actively to dismantle apartheid and replace it with something else. Similarly, I think we not only need a pretty sophisticated understanding of the problem of climate change, but we also need to understand what do we need to do to reduce emissions and adapt to the changes that are underway, right? To follow our line of thinking to that level. And certainly the dismantling of capitalism would go a long way toward that. But if we're waiting for capitalism to be dismantled first, it'll probably be too late. And a lot of people will suffer, right? So what can we do given the circumstances that we find ourselves in now? What can we do to make a difference? And that's the question we're all struggling with. And I have to say, I really oscillate between feeling really fatalistic that nothing can happen, that we're just like on this pathway to collapse, and feeling like that is ethically an untenable position. You can't hold on to that position. Because in a way, then, you know, you are fully in the grasp of denial, if you concede that point. We have to insist, right, that we still have a lot of choices that we can make and that we can act in the world, that we have agency, that we can fashion and find new forms of agency, and that that can lead us to all sorts of different pathways that would be much better than the one we're on now. And this seems to me also where literature is important, because this is really the imagination of alternatives that can become more real because we've imagined it into being, rather than the fatalism of what might be called capitalist realism, that this is as good as it gets. We just have to make do with it. How do we imagine alternatives and then try to bring it into being? That seems to me an urgent and important task. And fatalism is to give up before we even try.
Yes, well put indeed. Well, maybe I can ask a follow-up question from João as well. So could you elaborate on what you mean by shared agency and give a couple of examples of how you think it might be effective? And would you say it is unrealistic these days to think about broader forms of collective action, meaning that we might involve people from all walks of life, or are we condemned to keep preaching to the converted?
Yeah, I think individually we have a very weak agency in the world. You know, we can't affect big change. It also feels to me that the share of agency is often concentrated in a few individuals who have access to enormous wealth and power, but also their agency is a little tied because their wealth and power is tied to the status quo. And in some ways they can't advocate for change without giving up the very things that give them their wealth and power. But collectively we do have power. You know, and that's, I think, consistently been shown. So how do we organize ourselves into being effective? And here, I think, at the local level, there's a lot of good news. People are doing it all everywhere, you know, collectively. People are getting together, looking at their very local communities, right? And thinking in very, very practical terms about creating infrastructure that is less dependent on automobiles, that's less dependent on the burning of fossil fuels, that are finding very reasonable things that make their lives less carbon intensive, which I think is especially important for places like Europe and the United States, where we are so responsible for so much individual emission, right? I think that actually is really important. There are also lots of careful and important debates about adaptation, because I think regardless of what we do, there's still going to be lots of adaptation we'll have to do, and we really need to think carefully about that. At the very least, we need to think about adaptation to try to protect people from the harm that's surely going to come their way. Then now you've got people at the local level who are thinking about these issues, who are really actively engaged in their communities, who are talking to one another necessarily to pass local legislation, you know, ordinances, things that change their communities. You have an active and interested block of people who are engaged in the subject, and they are ripe for even more ambitious legislation, more ambitious policymaking, more ambitious changes to their lives, because they're alive to this possibility. They're alive to what is happening to them. And then it's a question at that next level of how do you organize those people? How do they organize themselves? Maybe is a better question. How do they organize themselves to work across different communities to build up their power even more? You know, their shared agency grows the more they can coordinate and work together and make those kinds of changes. Now, really smart laws can give shape, give form to that kind of energy that's already there at the local level, right? You create blocks of interest. One book that I've read recently that I think is really smart is by a political scientist at UC Santa Barbara named Leah Stokes. And she's looking at a few state level policies. And what policymakers are always thinking about when they're proposing new laws, according to her, is trying to create a kind of positive feedback loop where you create, you know, incentives or subsidies for a particular industry that you feel is really important to subsidize. Once you get that industry revved up and alive, you should have people who are really invested. Their self-interest is tied to that industry and its growth. They become a kind of important block of advocates. And as that block of voters grow and powerful people grow, they become even louder advocates for that policy, favors that industry, and more policies get passed, more legislation works in their benefit, and they grow into a major source of resistance. to the status quo because it's in their self-interest to change the society in a particular way. I don't know if I've done justice to her argument. It's quite subtle. But I really like this idea that you can then see at state levels policies and laws that are carefully cultivated to give more form, more shape to what people are already on the ground trying to accomplish, right? And especially policies geared toward lessening dependence on fossil fuels and moving toward as well as smart adaptations to the changes that are underway, because we need both of those things. And I think if you've already got a lot of people engaged and thinking hard about these issues, they're going to jump at the chance to escalate what they're doing at another level, right? So I do think that there is a lot of action happening now. That what I'm describing is not a hypothetical situation, but things that are already happening, that people are already doing these things. And we just need to keep on amplifying those good movements, those good active engagements, the people who keep challenging the status quo, but always with an eye toward creating something different. And I think this is where I really feel it's important that people not only advocate for the dismantling of the status quo, but can offer and articulate concrete alternatives about where we want to go as a community, as a society, as people. And underlying all of this is the importance also of trying to be part of a just transition. You know, it's one of the greatest tragedies in the world that the people least responsible for the problem of climate change are now suffering the worst effects. And we really, really need to address that inequality.
Yes, absolutely. Let's see, it has already been 1 hour. So, do the others have something that they would still like to add or ask
Yes, I don't resist to ask one more question, if it's possible. I will quote from the introduction. You said climate lyricism begins by turning anthropocentric habits of expression, especially the kind developed alongside the growth of European settler colonialism, back on themselves. So that the non-human is given human characteristics and asserts the kind of powers that humans are traditionally thought to be the only ones capable of possessing. I mean, I'm very curious about this in particular, and I would like you to talk a little bit more how this idea of back on themselves, how is it been doing? How is it working? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. That's a big question to ask. That line in the book comes from a lot of reading I'd been doing that was really trying to rethink the relationship between humans and things, sometimes broadly known, you know, under the category like new materialisms or vibrant matter or object-oriented ontology. I've been reading a lot of works and especially I was impressed by, I think, the brilliance of the work of someone like Jane Bennett, who's such a just a terrific scholar, and many, many others. You also, if you read the work of Amitav Ghosh in The Start of the Great Derangement, which is a really important intervention in the thinking about aesthetics and climate change, he talks a lot, he invokes those very ideas of things having a kind of vitality and an existence separate from us. And I really admire that way of thinking. And I was paying homage to that there, to think about how our action in the world is constrained by the physical world itself. And that we need to be mindful of a kind of separateness and existence that, or a coexistence that isn't so simply of human dominion over the world. Some of our problem stems from the fact that we think, you know, everything that's physically there is just there for our use and our amusement. And I think as a kind of a ecological perspective, that makes a lot of sense, and it's really important, you know. And I think also, you know, there's really interesting legislative experiments in countries outside the United States that's trying to think about, you know, what rights does a river have, or what rights does a forest have, things like that. So I think that's important. But as I kept on thinking about that scholarship, and as the chapter goes on, as the introduction goes on, it reflects my own thinking, the development of my own thinking on this. One frustration I have with it is that their understanding of human agency starts to see humans as lacking agency, as lacking power. And that felt to me just really frustrating and ultimately not reflective of what we're seeing, right? That you know, in many ways, what we see evidence all around us is the enormous power of humans when they band together in being able to affect change in the natural world. And so, you know, how can we then try to pretend that that's not the case? You know, and if we want to imagine a future, right, full of humans who have found a way to coexist with the non-human world, so that we aren't imperiling ourselves or the non-human world, you know, we can't get there without appreciating the power that humans have and trying to find forms that allow us, you know, to develop social relationships that are less damaging to ourselves as well as to non-humans. I don't know if that made sense. It's as far as my thinking has gone so far on that. But
it did. Thank you.
If I may, I also have a quick, I'm trying to make it a quick question. I have so many more questions, but I'm going to reduce it to the one, which maybe, I think it adds to maybe the point on denial, which I really read as something that is maybe a little bit inevitable as well. That's something that we just have to kind of live with. It's almost like a tipping point maybe, which can then turn into potentiality as well and turn either way. And I was thinking about the future and obviously how we don't know what the future holds, and the future is unknown, but I also think that maybe the past is unknown to us in a way, because there's so many different stories and we never get a full picture of it, right? And I was thinking about this idea of nostalgia and how we always critique, obviously, the idea that there was never a point where we were one with nature and we never had this paradise on earth. But I wonder, to what extent does this idea still feed into our ideas of how we imagine the future? Is that still based on the idea that we can have some sort of big universal paradise? And if that is the case, how can we create everyday practices that challenge that idea and that make us search for this paradise in the cracks of society and in the way that Anand Singh maybe describes capitalist ruins, and how can we kind of create those spaces where we can live fulfilled lives in a different way than what is possible at the moment?
That is not an easy answer, an easy question. I'd say first that, you know, when I think about denial, I think, you know, to some degree, maybe a certain level of denial is necessary if we want to be able to occupy an everyday existence. Otherwise, we probably just tear ourselves apart mentally and psychologically. So you know, there's always a kind of dance between denial and acceptance of what's happening, or engagement with what's happening. That's something I'm still working on and thinking through. But I also think about the uses of the past, the question, you know, there is always the trap of nostalgia, right? Of thinking about a kind of pristine past that we might want to go to. And I think whatever we do in the future, you know, and one of the challenges of trying to imagine the future, I think, is that it probably won't replicate anything in the past. It's something we're going to have to figure out that's pretty new. And that's really challenging. On the other hand, I think when we think about the past, or when I hear people talk about the past, it's usually like the wrong time frame. It's usually like only a few years or a few decades, even, you know. It's not that deep a sense of the past, you know. And increasingly, I think the time frames that really matter for the kinds of debates we want to have about the environment, but also about like social inequality and race and gender and those things, that the time frame has to be like centuries. And we really need to go all the way back, at least to, you know, the 15th century, and really think about those moments of contact, because that's really also the moments when capitalism emerges as a kind of universalist discourse that's going to transform the whole world, not just small, you know, individual societies. And I think we need to really think about that longer period. I've been trying to think about that longer period, and it does change my perspective on the challenges we face. I think our understanding of that era is deeply flawed, and we need to create a kind of interpretive frame that begins with the assumptions of several centuries of history, not just a few decades or a few years. And then that will allow us also to think about this kind of challenges in a new way, and I hope a productive way. And I think a lot of scholars are doing that, just really brilliant, smart work. I think the work of like Sylvia Winter, for instance, the Jamaican scholar and intellectual, just she's growing more and more important every year because she's the one who's kind of thinking in those kinds of time frames to try to understand what was happening locally for her. I understand people are kind of skeptical of like big history, something. But I also think that like David Graeber and David Wengrow's book, The Dawn of Everything, which is an attempt to try to make sense of the big sweep of human history, is an admirable attempt at rejiggering our sense of time. You know, as they point out at the start of their book, you know, as far as we know, humans in their current physiology have basically existed without that much change for at least 200,000 years preceding the last ice age. Humans have been around for a long time in our current form. And during all those years, humans have pretty much tried everything. So, you know, in a way, we're part of a continuous experiment in sociality where we keep on trying things and then deciding it doesn't work and abandoning it and trying something different. Yeah, you know, which I think is meant to be very encouraging for us, because then we could say, you know, whatever we find ourselves in now, whatever situation we find ourselves in now, that leaving so many of us feeling stuck and powerless is also part of a longer history of humans developing systems like this, looking around and saying, you know what, this doesn't work, then trying something different entirely, you know. Maybe we're at one of those moments in time when humans will just kind of look around, see what we've built and say, you know, maybe we could do things differently.
Thank you.
All right. Yes, thank you. I think we then need to start wrapping this up, but this has been a really important and interesting discussion. I think it would be great to carry on for a longer time, but I was told that we should keep it to roughly an hour. So yeah, let me just end by saying that indeed, this has been an important discussion, one that perhaps can give us hope as well, that we can do things and have shared agency. And that is of course, true of the book Climate Lyricism as well. It is a book that felt important to read, and not just in order for me to learn about what literature does, even though as a literary scholar, that's what I'm interested in, but also in thinking about broader issues. So I think that's really saying something about the role that not just literature, but also literary criticism can have in thinking about important questions. So yes, thank you for that. And thank you everyone for participating in this discussion.
Thank you so much. This is great. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk about my work. And thank you also for engaging with it. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I feel like discussions like these, they're also a form of community building, I guess. And yes. Reading, I always think about reading communities or reading groups as also being part of the bigger building communities.
Yes, indeed. All right. So yeah, thank you everyone, and bye.
Bye.
Thank you, bye.